The Redeemer's Coming, The Sherlock Holmes Advent Calendar, by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and Nora Godwin, narrated by Bryan Godwin. Part 8, Genetics. After Brother Peter's somewhat rudimentary outlines, I understood what was going on and immediately jumped up, grabbed my doctor's bag, and ran straight towards the library. While the vicar, who also did not give himself a break, immediately clung to my heels, Lestrade and Holmes followed with a bit of a distance. Arriving at the library, I couldn't spot Brother Nicholas at first. Only Brother Peter led me through the labyrinth of bookshelves into a side room. It was the one with the indexed books. There, Brother Nicholas laid on the ground in a large pool of blood. Immediately, I saw the wound on the back of his head. The librarian had fallen onto the ground, the backside of his head facing toward the top. Obviously, this accident was brought about with human influence. I bent over him and felt his pulse on his neck, but I couldn't feel a heartbeat. I turned the body around with considerable effort, but in all consequence, I had to acknowledge that the librarian could no longer be helped. "He's dead," I resignedly said, as Holmes and Lestrade arrived after the vicar. "Oh no," cried Brother Peter. "What a misfortune!"
"Was it a misfortune?" asked Holmes immediately.
"It wasn't an accident, that is for sure," I explained.
At this stage, I would say that Brother Peter lost consciousness and fell to the ground due to his deep wound on the back of his head. He also lost a lot of blood. He had no chance for survival. However, this wound does not stem from the fall itself, but is, on the contrary, etiologic. It was inflicted on him by a violent blow with a hard object. What we are dealing with is another devious murder."
"For heaven's sake," lamented the otherwise brisk vicar. "That will not please the papal envoy at all."
"Rightly so," said Lestrade. "My patience is coming to an end too. Surely it is not acceptable for a spiritual serial offender to lead us around in this way. Holmes, what do you intend to do now?"
The addressee remained calm and looked around the room. "I will inspect the crime scene," he said. "What else?"
"What do you see?" the inspector asked immediately.
"As Dr. Watson suggested," Holmes began, "the attack took place from behind, according to the pattern of the attack on Brother Emmanuel. The crime weapon may have been similar or even the same. Brother Nicholas was surprised, beaten down, and fatally wounded. But what has he done here? In any case, he did not put back the critiques on the elements of the philosophy of right by Hegel's, since it is still standing on the desk. Watson, what book is open at the table here?"
In fact, a small ribbon was placed on the small table next to the dead. The suspicion was that the librarian was devoting himself or dedicating himself to this reading.
I slammed the book and read on the front, "Experiments on Plant Hybrids, in German, by a certain Gregor Mendel, born 1866.
"A work on botany," said Lestrade disapprovingly. "I don't know how experimental gardening will help us here."
"Oh, it's much more than that," Holmes said, who apparently already knew this script. "Mendel, an Austrian Augustinian abbot, undertook crossbreeding experiments with pea plants over several generations, evaluated them statistically, and thus developed general views on the theory of inheritance. Although committed to the Catholic Church, Mendel came to results that could not only confirm Darwin's central findings, but could also evolve on the important issues. But this is controversial, and not only on the church side."
"Why this?" I asked, and I was a little ashamed that, as a medical doctor, I had never heard of it.
"Well, that's because of the possible practical application of the findings," Holmes said. "When we get behind the mystery of the inheritance of certain characteristics, discover real laws of inheritance, this ultimately allows for the targeted breeding of new species by crossing, at least the promotion of desired characteristics. Just imagine that we would do this not only with pea plants, but with animals or even with humans. You could create perfect specimens. Evolution would be in our hands."
"It is not for man to play God," the vicar shouted in a strict tone.
I was not comfortable with this idea either, although I looked at it from a purely scientific point of view. "Evolution is based on coincidences and adaptations to external influences, trial and error, repetition and success," I argued.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.